much should I turn? Check, 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 check. Yep.
That's good. All right. My name is David Huey. I'm in the center microphone. Mine says number one on it. Number one, Kevin Ross, you are in
number
two.
And I would be on number three.
Yeah, we can hear our voices.
Yep. Check. Yep. Sounds good.
Closer.
Yeah.
Now I got to hear myself more.
Yeah.
Great.
Don't you hate that?
I do hate it.
Sounds good. Yeah. Check. Yeah, I can't hear Mondo's voice at all.
No, no, nice.
We can't hear you at all. We can't hear the tech booth.
We can hear you now.
In a year that can only be described as tumultuous, we have gathered here today a group of individuals that define perseverance. Starting with coaches slash gym owners that have adapted their teaching styles to fit new regulations and constantly changing restrictions, to the fighters themselves that have stayed mentally and physically sharp, even though there was no opportunities for competition in sight, and of course, Triumphant itself with leaders like Jeff Corris and Zay Martinez, who somehow, some way, have put together this beautiful outdoor venue so we can provide a platform for these fighters to safely display their skills in the ring here this afternoon. That's right, I am Brandon Kyle, and we are once again here, this time in the beautiful city of Rosarito in Baja California, to prevent you blazing full rules Muay Thai action right here at Triumphant Muay Thai Series 9. And of course, it would not be a triumphant if I did not have my good friend and co-host, David Huey. David, they said it was going to be a fight with a view, and they did not disappoint.
Oh, absolutely. I'm going to call Triumphant 9 Triumphant International, because not only we are here in beautiful Rosarito, Mexico, but they have brought fighters through representing throughout the world, Asia, Australia, throughout the Americas, and of course, Mexico itself. And across five different states of America, they have converged here. Triumphant is bringing you three amateur fights, seven professional fights, a WMC Intercontinental title fight, and also a Triumphant World title. This is truly Triumphant International.
That's right, David. And let's talk about one of those amateur fights that we're here to see, where Philip Ignacio returns to the Triumphant ring, and we've seen him defeat a great Jake Haas on previous Triumphant. He takes on a really, really tough fighter, and a fighter you know a little bit well because you kind of started his fight career in Brandon Kurosawa.
You know what? I'm going to call this fight Hardware Wars. Between them, they have seven belts. Seven belts between them. They're on the cusp of being professional fighters. But what you're going to see is a highly technical bout in five rounds. The difference between a pro and an amateur. A pro fights 3-minute round. The amateurs fight a 2-minute round. But this one is going to have 3 minutes of action in 2 minutes, and that's going to be a great, great fight.
That's right. These guys together have more belts than the men's department at Walmart. Speaking of belts, we have a first time awarded Triumphant cruiserweight title on the line here tonight, when a bull of a man, Jacob Rodriguez takes on Alberto Amaro in our co-main event. David, what do you think about that fight?
You know, I got the opportunity to interview both of these fighters, and I asked, what is your fight style? How you see yourself fighting? They talk about, hey, I'm a forward fighter. I use high pressure. I don't back down. Both of them said the exact same thing. When you have two fighters wanting a triumphant world title and coming out both forward, both banging, you know what? We're going to have a new universe. You know why? A new Big Bang is going to happen.
The Big Bang, that's right. An unstoppable force meets an immovable object here in that co-main event. And in our main event, we have Jose Ruelas taking on a streaking Zach Bonelli. He's coming off a very short notice fight. Actually, he got this. Said he got the call on Sunday, but you know he stays ready. And you know, because it's such a big fight, you know, David and I didn't think we could do it ourselves, so we had to enlist the help of our guest commentator here today. He is a world champion in kickboxing and in Muay Thai. He really needs no introduction. I'm talking, of course, of the Soul Assassin, Kevin Ross. Kevin, now you have some experience with Zach Bonnell coming in, trying to fight for that WMC Intercontinental title. Tell us a little bit about working with Zach and what you think about that fight here today.
Yeah, you know, I've known Zach for quite a few years. We've trained together in Thailand, up north, down south in San Diego, and we've beaten each other up all over the world, and he's always a gamer. He's always ready to fight. He takes fights on the shortest of notice, just like I used to do, and those tend to be the exciting ones because he knows he's the underdog. He knows it's short notice, and he's coming to put on a show. So I'm really looking forward to that one.
Yeah, David, what do you think about that main event here tonight?
You know, as a coach, I've had fighters always say, "Hey, I'm willing to take a fight anytime, coach," and that's a lot of talk. When it comes down to it, not all of them come up and step up to the plate. Oh, I'm not ready. I didn't get in shape. I got to be too fat, you know. Who's the opponent? But this guy got the call Sunday night and said, hey, you know, let's do it. But when I interviewed him, he says, look, he's always training. You know, he has a regimen. He does 20 minutes of rope work, works the bag, 500 teeps, you know, sparring 9 rounds. He is always ready. This is a fighter that stays ready. So he is ready. So he doesn't need to get ready. And that's a fantastic thing. But on the opposite side, Jose Ruelas, he stepped in front of one of my fighters 6 years ago, and he dismantled him in 2 rounds, you know. So I see a highly, highly war of attrition here. Zach Bonnell is going to fight a lot with his heart, and Jose Ruelas is going to have to figure out something because, you know what, a new opponent in the game.
Yeah, and you know, we expect nothing but fireworks in that main event for that WMC Intercontinental title. Folks, we have a couple things to batten down before we begin our show, so we enjoy. Please join us ringside while we kind of wait for this bad boy to get started. And soon enough, we will begin Triumphant Muay Thai Series 9. We're here in beautiful California, right by the beach here. You see the ring is set up, literally with the coast in view at this beautiful Rosarito Beach Resort Hotel. The folks here at Triumphant set everybody up with these wonderful accommodations. Kevin, when did you get in? You just get in today?
I got in about an hour ago, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. What are you thinking about Mexico? When's the last time you've been in Mexico? Have you been in Mexico before?
I spent a lot of time down here as a young man, getting into a lot of trouble.
I can only imagine.
I took a break for about 20 years, and it's nice to be back now and to see Muay Thai out here. In this beautiful beach with all these people enjoying it.
Have you noticed any changes in Mexico, you know, the way it kind of looks or feels? I know it's a different time right now than the last time you were here.
Yeah, it's hard to say. Everything's so surreal these days.
Right.
You know, you don't really have a reference for what it used to be. Everything's so different and new. It feels like a dream out here. Like you don't know what's going on.
Yeah, David, you've spent some time down here. I believe you've coached a couple fights out here in Rosarito and Tijuana. Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, we've been out here several times, popping some beers out in TJ. You know, the crowd is just fantastic. And though this time we're gonna have a limited crowd because Triumph is taking all the safety protocols here. They're limiting the audience. They're limiting the numbers here. We've all had our COVID tests. The fighters had COVID tests. The coaches had COVID tests. This is one of the safest venues around.
Yeah, definitely. And now as far as, you know, venues to fight in, Kevin, I mean, it's been a tough year to be a fighter. Obviously, it's almost impossible to throw a show. You can't have anything indoor. It's hard for a promoter to throw a show when they can't sell tickets. In the mind of a fighter, how has it been this year, knowing that, you know, there's probably not going to be an opportunity to compete, you know, or very limited opportunities to compete, obviously, since we're doing one here today. But is it kind of mentally tasking to have to continue to train, knowing that, you know, you don't get to go out there and let it out in the ring in a competition?
Yeah, it is. It is not knowing what's coming, if anything's ever going to come again, you know, trying to battle that, staying ready but not burning yourself out and getting frustrated when you see the ups and downs of the country and the world, never knowing when there's going to be another fight again. But having that always staying ready mentality that you need to have anyway if you ever want to be a high-level fighter, this kind of just solidifies the fact that you never know what's going to come. And like Zach, you know, he stayed ready and got the call, and now he's going to be on the main event there.
Yeah, that's right. I saw Zach about 2-3 weeks ago in Reno, and you know, whenever you see a fighter, you give him a little gut check, you know, see, you know, feel his shoulder, punch his stomach a little bit to see where he's at. I tell you, every time I see Zach, I give him the gut check, and he's like hitting a brick wall. I mean, he's always in shape. He's always lean, you know. You never really see him. He's always training. You know, he has a crazy morning regimen. He says he trains 2-3 hours a day. David, he was talking to us about it. Kind of like a Rocky-type regimen. You know, he's probably cracking raw eggs in a glass and drinking them in the morning type thing. David, as far as it being a gym owner, you know, I know you own a gym in North Hollywood in Southern California. I mean, how's it been for you to try to – you know, transition and deal with all these constant changes and opens and closes and inside, outside? I mean, has it been difficult for you as a gym owner?
Well, you know, in a situation like this, you can tell who wants to really be a fighter, you know, because they will make their way. They will come out and train in the garage. They will come and train outside. They will do whatever it takes in the park if they really want to be a fighter. So this pandemic has really separated those who really want it and those that talk about it. And that's one of the most important things that I see as a coach, coaching fighters. Who really wants it during this time when it's difficult? You know, the fights are not going to be easy, but who's going to persevere? And that's one of the exciting things I saw.
Yeah, you know, and what I realized, too, is that these fighters, I mean, physically it's easier. I think it's easier to stay in shape physically than it is almost to stay sharp mentally through all of this. I mean, it's easy, especially, you know, when you have these long bouts where you don't get to train. And I know for a lot of these fighters, you know, it's more than just a physical and mental aspect. It's a social aspect as well. So, you know, you don't get to spend time with your friends. Kevin, has it been difficult to, you know, to not be able to train with your normal training partners and just have that outlet to kind of release, you know, mental, you know, stress and whatnot in your day-to-day, you know, life?
Yeah, without question. Muay Thai for me is my therapy. It's my church. It's my psychologist. You know, it's all of these things that allow me to get all that energy out, to work through things physically, mentally, emotionally. And when you don't have that outlet, it's an extreme strain on you. And I think that's added to a lot of things that people are already dealing with depression and mental health issues and psychological issues. If you don't have that outlet to vent, especially in a positive physical way, it can be very difficult. So trying to stay motivated doing
now,
this.
Now, Kevin, as a fighter, you've taken fights at the last moment, okay? And
yeah.
As a fighter, what do you have to do prepare mentally in that ring or before you step into that ring? What do you have to do, knowing that you do have certain limitations, you know? Tell me about your experience, and tell me about what Zach needs to overcome to do that.
You know, for me, it was I learned a lot of lessons because I did this so many different times, and there was times I felt like, oh, I'm not in the best shape I want to be in. I'm gonna try to take my time and go easy. But that's not really my style anyway, so trying to do that made me more tired. So it's like, if I just went out there and just fought like I would always fight, regardless of how much preparation I had, I would fight better. You know, you don't want to put those mental limitations on yourself. Well, I didn't get to train the full camp. Maybe I had to cut too much weight, whatever it may be. But when you're in the ring, you just got to let it go. You can't even worry about all those things because they might not even matter anyway.
Now, do you think that might be a little bit of an advantage? You know, sometimes I know fighters sometimes can get in their own head. Say you got 6-8 weeks where you're in camp grinding in and out, thinking about one opponent. And then, you know, on the flip side, you have Zach where you call him on Sunday. He's in shape. He feels good. And they say, hey, you want to get in there and fight for this WMC title, which he deserves because he has so much experience. You know, so, can it be an advantage too to just say, hey, you know, it's kind of like a little pressure off your back
because
you don't have expectations. You know,
for sure.
People say, man, look, you know, if you win and you kill it and win the championship, wow, he did that on 6 days' notice.
Right.
If you lose but you have a good fight, it's the same. Like, well, shoot, he only had 6 days' notice. So does it give you a little bit of pressure off your shoulders when you go in there?
Without question. You know, no matter what, you came out here, you filled in, you made it so there was a fight on the card. Any amount you did well is going to be great. Even if you don't win, you look bad. You came out here and you did the work, and you got another fight under your belt. You had some more experience in the ring. It's just a win-win situation. You know, you got nothing to lose. So go out there and just let it go and have fun.
Well, and I think in a time like this, you know, a fighter gets a call and there's actually a promotion that's throwing a fight. I mean, at this point, I feel like there are dozens of fighters that would jump to take this opportunity, you know, just because the scarcity of the ability to compete. So, you know, I really do commend Zach on this. Like I said, every time I see him, hey, man, when's the next Triumphant? Can you get me on? He wants to get on any minute. And that's what I appreciate about a guy like Zach is true warrior spirit, where, you know, he just wants to compete. You know, it doesn't matter. You know, if we said we're going to pitch against Israel Adesanya tomorrow, he would take the fight, I think, honestly,
for sure.
So that's amazing. Now, you know, as far as, you know, mental therapy and whatnot, you know, obviously you don't get to train, you know, the way you like, but you do other things too. You're very much a warrior poet. You're a writer and an artist. Have you kind of delved into other aspects of your life, not being able to kind of train the way you're used to?
Yeah, I have. I've been able to put a lot more time into my art and my writing and things like that. But at the same time, I do have to maintain a certain level of shape and focus. And so it's not like I'm been on vacation and I can put 100% more time into these other things, just a little bit more time.
Yeah.
So it's been good to explore those other avenues and have a little bit more time on that. But still, I'm in the gym every day, whether that's with other people or by myself, which most of the time it has been.
Yeah, yeah, a lot of people doing garage workouts or, you know, those who have access to a gym, you know. I know it's been difficult. Now, personally, do you have a fear of, you know, possibly getting, you know, sick or anything like that when you do train with other partners?
No, you know, the biggest fear, I think, for me, I mean, I haven't had a fight yet, but when you do have a fight, you're so excited that the fight's going to happen. There's already an infinite number of things that can go wrong, and now you got to worry about, well, if somebody tests positive, even if they're not sick, it's just over and done. Like, Joe Schilling was supposed to fight 3 weeks ago, and one of his training partners tested, and none of them were allowed to fight, even though they were all negative. So
yeah, it's such an it's an unknowing time, you know. And so I think, you know, always better safe than sorry. But it's difficult to see a situation like that where, you know, two of the combatants involved in an actual fight don't even test positive, but, you know, someone that they're associated with or, you know, that have had contact with has, and then they have to scrap that whole thing. You know, we've seen several cards really, you know, valiantly attempt to throw cards. There was supposed to be a fight in Southern California, I think, tomorrow that got scrapped, unfortunately. Yeah. And I see it happening all over. I had a friend of mine, an MMA fighter. They said, what are you doing in New Orleans? I'm watching his story on Instagram. What are you doing in New Orleans? He goes, oh, I was supposed to fight. But they scrapped the show after they flew everybody out. And now I just got a free vacation, which is it's cool for him. But on the flip side, you know, a promoter that would, you know, might have thrown 10 shows over the next 2 years might not be able to throw a show because he lost quite a bit of money, probably flying all those fighters out and not be able to recoup anything back. So I know it's a difficult time for everyone in the sport. And that's why it goes to show what an accomplishment it is that we're even able to be here right now doing this. I honestly didn't think that we were going to be able to get a show going on. But, you know, Jeff Corris and Zay Martinez, they secured this outdoor venue. And not only is it – and it's not a desperation show. It doesn't feel like, oh, this is, you know, we're in some bum whatever town in the middle of nowhere type thing. We're on a beautiful beach in Baja California in Rosarito, you know. So it's great to see to see a promotion persevere through this, because I know it was always Triumphant's plan to go international. And David, you know, like you mentioned,
absolutely,
that we finally are here in Mexico, of all places, in a wonderful, beautiful place. And so excited about the show here today.
And if you're watching right now, you're probably watching the free stream. We have three preliminaries, and we have one pro card, and then we're going to go to the pay-per-view. So you guys log on to the pay-per-view and Facebook. It's only $7.99. You know, that's the price of this. and a price of a muffin, okay? And you can keep and support the art of Muay Thai. We need to show there's an audience out there. We got to show there's an audience out there for this to continue. It gives opportunities for fighters to continue. It gives opportunities for gyms to continue. It keeps the sport growing. And you know what? Muay Thai, the art of eight limbs, the sport of kings, the national sport of Thailand, combatants using two fists, two elbows, two knees, 2 feet. It is arguably the most exciting form of stand-up fighting in the world. Do you agree, Kevin?
100%. It's the best there is. And no matter what level the fight is, they're always exciting. I don't know if I've ever seen a boring Muay Thai fight.
Yeah, and I'll tell you what. Now, David said the price of a coffee and muffin, that's probably in the States here. But, you know, you can get two muffins and two coffees for the price of the pay-per-view here in Mexico. Guys, $7.99 for the pay-per-view. That is a great deal to see live full rules of Muay Thai action here today. But, of course, before that, we're going to give you guys a little teaser sampler for free. Check it out on Fight Hub TV. You guys can go and stream the fights here or Facebook. Go to Triumphant Combat Sports Facebook and get that pay-per-view going. But we're going to give you guys a couple of these amateur fights. Speaking of amateur fights, we got some great fights. And, you know, let's talk about that Philip Ignacio, Brandon Kurosawa. Now, you seem familiar. I didn't realize that you had actually a coach of Brandon's early in his career.
Well, when he first got started in Muay Thai, he came to the gym. And you know what? You get a lot of people say, hey, coach, I want to fight. I want to fight, you know. But when someone takes a class, stays after class, continues to train after class, wants to perfect this, wants to know that, you know you have a fighter in the making. And this guy eventually moved to San Diego, got great work in the boxing club. Jesse Magazine's been working with them. He's been working with a lot of great champions. Everybody out there has put in. They have crafted a very, very good fighter out of Brandon Kurosawa, you know. And again, I call this bout hardware wars, you know. They have seven belts between them. And these are, you know, some IKF belts, some great, great belts there. And they are on the cusp of becoming professionals. And they have the technique, the power, but they have to consolidate all that action in 2 minutes, you know. And Kevin, what was your experience transitioning from an amateur to a pro?
I got thrown into the deep end. You know, my very first pro fight was against a national champion. He had 32, I think he was 32-1. And I took it on 10 days notice because his guy fell through. So I really got thrown into the deep water, which has been a theme in my entire career from the beginning to the end, is just taking any fight I could get, regardless of level of opponent. And I had to kind of face that day one, just like my very first fight I ever had. I fought a guy with 20-something fights, 25 pounds on me. And I was forced to face a lot of those things that you will inevitably face throughout your career, but I had to deal with them
very
day
early.
One. Yeah, so I didn't deal with that, like those like that undefeated streak that a lot of people have that can tell many times limit them from progressing the way they need to and putting the right work in. But when you lose, especially when you lose badly, you have to face that, or when you have to face somebody that's at such a higher level, you have to step up.
Yeah, and I hear fighters say that a lot. They say that I was 13-0 and undefeated. It wasn't until I went 13-1 that I really learned myself and learned, you know, how to overcome those, you know, mental blocks and barriers that can come after a loss. Because, you know, you win 10, 13 fights, 15 fights, all of a sudden that loss, and like you said, if it's a bad loss, it can make or break some fighters, really. Mm-hmm. Some fighters really never bounce back from that. It kind of determines whether you got it or not to really push deep into a fighting career.
For sure. And it's like the difference between sparring and an amateur fight is the difference between an amateur fight and a pro fight. You don't realize what it feels like, what it looks like. You don't have a concept of what it is. You just see it on TV and be like, oh, it's just the same thing I do, just maybe better and faster and stronger. But it's night and day difference, and you really have your eyes opened up to what it's like to be in there with on the pro level.
Now, Kevin, correct me if I'm wrong, but is this the bout that you got your nickname, the Soul Assassin?
Yes, sir.
Okay, and tell us about that, huh?
Yeah, I can tell you about that. So my very first professional fight, as I said, was actually in Guadalajara, Mexico. The guy I was fighting was the national champion at the time, and took it on 2 weeks' notice. He was supposed to obviously walk right through me. I think they called me up just so he could have an easy fight, because he had actually just recently lost a bout and wanted to get his confidence up again. But we had this crazy war. I had actually smashed my shin so badly a week before the fight that I couldn't even touch my shin without falling to the ground in pain. But he ended up cutting me in the first round, and I just switched into just psycho die mode.
Live or die.
Like I tried to bug out. Like I said, you know, you take a fight on short notice. You're trying to be smart about it, but as soon as you get clipped with something, it's like, well, you can't try to be safe. This is a fight. You got to fight. And I just kind of walked through everything he did, and eventually just ended up knocking him out. And a guy afterwards told me that it looked like I assassinated his soul, and that should be my nickname because I just broke him down mentally and physically. And just refused to quit.
Oh, so not like the shoe. Like, we thought you were just running so hard. You just went through your running shoes.
I was running forward a lot, so maybe that's what he meant.
Kevin took a picture of my dog, Anime, and my dog is actually the soulless house. She takes shoes. She just splits them away. So I have the soul assassin with the real soul assassin.
Well, it's funny because we're talking to one of the prelim fighters, Orlando Angulo, yesterday. And I said, you know, we asked the same. Kevin Ross and Chaz Mulkey. And I said, well, you know, that's funny because Kevin Ross is commentating your fight tomorrow. And you should have seen his face just like, he looked like a little kid at Christmas. He said, really? And he just looked down like, he's living the dream right now, you know? So, and then, like you said, just the pressure of a show like this. Mm-hmm. What a great stage for the amateurs, right? Yeah. To be on a show like this with the pros, mm-hmm. and a guy like Kevin Ross, and then the very handsome David Huey, and then they got me. I don't know how I got here. But, you know, just being on a stage like this, I mean, imagine what it's like. I mean, what would it be like, you know, to be an amateur and, like, this is where you're fighting, you know? It really, talk about experience. And it's great to be able to provide some of these amateur fighters with this experience. And,
absolutely.
Speaking of amateur fighters, you know, like Philip Ignacio and Brandon Curros, like you said, they can't really be amateurs very much longer. They have so much experience. Every time I see Philip, I'm like, hey, when are you going to make the jump? When are you going to make the jump? I think this was the year for him, he said, to make the jump. But unfortunately, obviously, you know, it's been difficult to get competition. So making that pro jump, and you know, it's really unfortunate. But at least we're back on here, and you know, it looks like everybody again is following the safety protocols. You know what I noticed, and I wasn't sure about it. And, you know, my predeterminations coming here, I thought it would be more laxed than the States, but I feel like the culture here is even more, I guess, safe and being safeguarded. I see everyone's wearing masks, even walking the sidewalks. And it doesn't seem like anybody has an issue with it here. So it's been wonderful to be in Mexico and see kind of everybody going along with the program. And they have a COVID task force here, especially for events. So, you know, they're here checking and making sure there's a couple officials around, just walking around, making sure everyone is following the protocols. Obviously, we're outside, which makes it a lot easy for us to follow all these safety protocols. But again, from day one, Jeff and Zay have let everybody know, staff, fighters, coaches, that how important it is to follow these protocols, because our number one importance is keeping everybody safe and everyone go home and not have to worry about any health situations or scares like that. So,
oh, absolutely. And because we all had our COVID test, and that's why we are able to talk on this broadcast without a mask on, but it was mandated by the promotion. All fighters, all coaches, even ourselves, take that COVID test and make sure that we're able to do this under the safest guidelines as possible, and that's why we're here talking without mask on.
Yeah, everyone, really, pretty much everyone involved, even down to the grips and then the people helping putting together the stages and whatnot. You know, everybody has been checked and is safe, and we couldn't be happier that everything's going smoothly. We didn't have any issues. We did have one of the prelims fight off, but that was more of a travel issue. I think with visas and whatnot, one of the fighters wasn't able to make it down with their coaches, which is unfortunate. So yeah, we will have to scrap that very initial fight just because of that. But other than that, you know, been a flawless show. Everybody is healthy and is ready to compete, and no one has issues with the guidelines. And we are very close to starting Triumphant 9 here.
Yeah, they say that we're like 5 minutes away. And so, guys, if you have a chance, order that pay-per-view on Facebook. It's only $7.99. $7.99. You're going to see some of the best Muay Thai fights out there. 7 professional fights, 3 amateur fights. We have 3 female fights, and female Muay Thai is really coming up tremendously. Kevin, female Muay fights, what are your thoughts? And have you seen female Muay Thai fights in Thailand? What is the culture like? What is it happening here? What's going on?
Yeah, it's interesting because I don't think a lot of people know how illegal or not allowed female fighting is in Thailand.
Really?
Or was. I don't know what the degree they're allowed to now, but even on the ring, it says, like, they're not allowed to be in the ring. That's why the ring, they usually have the ring card girls in a separate area, mm-hmm. standing off to the side because they're very superstitious about women being in the ring. So many, many gyms didn't even allow females in them until much more recently. A lot of these females were doing the kind of the quarantine training, you know, doing what they could in their garages.
Oh, yeah, and, privately.
But I think that almost gives them more motivation when they do come out. They always feel like the underdog that they need to put on a show. And every time there's a female fight, they're out there looking to take each other's heads off. I think a lot of that plays into that role. You know, when you're going into somebody else's hometown or when you're an underdog, you're like, I'm here to make a name for myself and to show what I'm made of. So they're always out there giving it everything they got.
Well, and I think that's what makes some of these female bouts so great is they come in a bit because of that, like oppression of the ability to fight. When they come in, they do come in with a chip on their shoulder with something to prove that they're just as tough as the boys and they can scrap and just as technical, just as trained, just as aggressive. Mm-hmm. And so you kind of see all of it, and you see it all come out in the ring, and that's why it's great.
That's great. You know, we're 2 minutes out, and, you know, we're going to open this bout here with Kendra Lynn and Mackenzie Himes. What do you know about these fighters?
Well, you know, Kendra Lynn, New York State, she's in the Air Force. She's an E6 in the Air Force, actually, and got stationed in Hawaii about 2 years ago. She started training with Richard De Los Reyes and Mango Tree. And so she's been training about 2 years out there in Hawaii. She's actually making the transition from MMA. She's 5-0 in amateur MMA, but she's been training Muay Thai the last 2 years. And so this will be her first Muay Thai competition. And then she's taken on Mackenzie McSpeedy Himes. She's 4-1 in Muay Thai. She's a Mesh out of San Leandro fighter, Ivan Ramos. We have a couple fighters, Philip Ignacio as well, one of her teammates. They'll be fighting here. And, you know, she started training just because she wanted a challenge. She was actually a high-level softball player in high school. Recruited in college, one of the top recruits in the country. And when she was done playing softball, she kind of realized, you know, there's not really a career in it. So she wanted to challenge herself with a new sport. And that's why she took up training. And she's been training for about 3-4 years now. And she likes footwork and angles. That's why they call her McSpeedy. I guess she's known for her speed in the gym. And Kendra Lynn, taller fighter, got a size advantage for sure. So Mackenzie will need that speed to kind of counteract the length of Lynn here in this opening fight.
Yeah, I'm excited for this one. It's an amateur fight, 3 rounds. And you know what? McSpeedy Himes, you know, she talked about being also the USMTO winner, and that's got to give her a lot of confidence in here. And she does have the experience more in Muay Thai because Kendra Lynn is making a transition from mixed martial arts to Muay Thai. But Kendra says she loves the striking art. She just loves it so much, and this is where she wants to be. Now, since we have a little bit of a moment, they want to give a shout-out. Kendra Lynn wanted to give a shout-out to her trainer, Richard De La Reyes, out in Hawaii. So, hey, Kendra says hi to you. And Mackenzie Himes says, hey, let's go, East Coast family, East Coast family. So you guys are on that pay-per-view, $7.99 on Facebook. We're going to get started really soon. If you guys are watching on Fight Hub TV, where you're getting the free preview, make sure you subscribe. Make sure you log into that pay-per-view for only $7.99. And we're going to send it to our ring announcer pretty soon, are we not?
I believe so. It looks like he's getting ready to call out the first fight. But okay. He is staged and ready to go.
Yes, and we're excited about that, okay? So once again, opening the bout, Kendra Lynn taking on Mackenzie Himes, triumphant number 9, as we call triumphant international, all the way from Hawaii. Kendra Lynn taking on from San Leandro, Mackenzie Himes. I'm excited about this opener.
I'm excited. You know, the temperature's a couple degrees warmer than it predicted. When I was coming down here, it said it was going to be 66, maybe 67 at the most. And it's about 72 degrees out here. Nice little breeze. It's beautiful. You know, sometimes when you're fighting outdoors, Kevin, you might have experience with this. and it's really hot. And I've seen fighters, and it's almost like they step on the ring, and it's like they're stepping on hot coals here. Fortunately for us, the sun is out, but it's cool with the breeze, so it looks like the canvas. Sometimes you see the steam coming off the canvas, can really affect the way you fight.
It can be brutal, like stepping on a hot stove, especially if you're out in the sun. You got the heat coming down. I actually fought once in China where the ring lights made the ring so hot.
Oh, wow. So imagine how hot you were from the heat of the lights.
Right. Yeah, it's pretty brutal. And, you know, dealing with the elements is always tricky. I mean, if it rains or something.
You never know.
It can be trouble. But fortunately, we have a beautiful day here. It's just the perfect temperature. Not too hot, not too cold. A little bit of a breeze. And hopefully it stays this way the rest of the card.
Kevin, as a fighter fighting outdoors, does the outdoor oxygen give you a little bit more fuel as opposed to, like, some smoking smoker-like environment?
Arena.
Sometimes the pyrotechnics, the smoke, and just being in those closed doors can really affect you. You're trying to get as much oxygen as possible in you, taking these deep breaths, and you're breathing in fumes and toxic chemicals. It's kind of the worst thing you could ever do. So it is nice to be outside, but as long as the weather's nice and you know, you're not dealing with rain or too much heat, those kinds of things. But yeah, it's beautiful here. Being able to see the beautiful ocean out there and everyone out here having a nice time, it's got to be a different kind of feeling when you're in the ring.
I was a horrible amateur MMA fighter at one point in my life, and I did have an opportunity to fight outside. And you know what? I honestly felt like I said, this is so gladiatorial. That's what I felt like. Like this, we're out in the elements. It felt like an arena, how they would fight, like the gladiator days, where it just, there is a different element when you're outside, I feel. Now, have you ever fought in the cold? Now, because I know sometimes, you know, if they have a nighttime fight in like the desert, Las Vegas or SoCal, sometimes it can get a little chilly. Have you ever had to fight and battle the cold? And what would you prefer? Would you rather have it almost too hot or too cold?
Always too hot. I despise the cold, especially when you're hitting things. It's painful enough as it is, and now everything's cold and you're
brittle.
You're more sensitive to the impact. So yeah, heat above all else for sure. Really, the only problem with the heat is your
canvas.
Feet.
Yeah, it gets a little hot here. Yeah, but again, like I said, this is the perfect weather for this event here today. And then you never know in November too. We are close to the equator, obviously, but you know tides can turn really quickly and get cold from day to day. So we're fortunate that the weather opened up here, and Rosarito's been great to us. David and I were dinner last night, and the waiter comes up, "Are you here for the fight?" "Yeah, oh, I read about it in the paper. Oh, they sold out of tickets." And I was like, wow, there's a buzz in the whole city. You know, as we're walking around, people can kind of know what we're here for. And I mean, if you'll be able to see, I don't know if you guys saw in the drone shot, but we're literally looking at the ocean right now as we broadcast this show. And I know the fighters are excited, and they are close to getting announced here, that their very first fight. And so we are excited here. I think we're almost there, guys. We are setting up here. Again, enjoy these first little preview here before the pay-per-view kicks off, the fourth fight. So we'll give you three fights to just check out on Fight Hub TV. And then eventually here, we're going to work into our pay-per-view. Only $7.99. Again, go to Triumphant Combat Sports Facebook page, and you can download that, stream that pay-per-view there. Support the sport and keep it going, because, you know, without you guys out there, without the fans, who we have to thank, you know, as well, we couldn't do this without you guys. It's so important for everyone to support the sport, you know, whether you just know somebody fighting casually. You know, I made all my friends buy it, even though they hate me and hate listening to me talk. They're like, we hear you talk enough in person. We don't need to hear you talk on TV too. But you know what? That's what it's all about, is community right now is so important. You know, coming together, helping your own, from your gyms to your restaurants, you know, just going out and supporting your local communities, guys. We got to keep these smaller businesses open. So just so grateful for everyone here that's going to buy our pay-per-view and check out the main events and the different belts we have on the line. It's really a stack card that Jeff Corris and Zay Martinez have put together here again today.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. You know, they're getting a signal here. Are we going to go soon? And if we are, guys, jump on that pay-per-view. Facebook pay-per-view, Triumph Combat Sports, $7.99. That's the price of a coffee and a muffin. And come out and support the art. And tell your friends, too. We got to keep this thing going because, you know, for it to be successful, limited audience that we have, we're going to have to just show that there is a fan base for this. You're not going to be able to come out and see these fights live. So you can't come out and see these fights live, then we got to show there's an audience for it, you know. And we guarantee you there's going to be some great fights here. 7 professional fights, okay. 3 amateur fights. We're going to start out with a female fight. Mackenzie Hines taking on Kendra Lynn. And we're getting, looking for our signal, Pablo Flores. Pablo Flores, our announcer. Looks like he's getting ready.
Yeah, you know, and usually, you know, we had scheduled Stefan Bonner as he announced our last show, you know, UFC Hall of Famer Stefan Bonner. He actually announced our last show in Las Vegas. Had some health issues and then had some other work obligations. So unfortunately, Stefan wasn't able to make this show as he planned to. But, yeah, we have Pablo Flores here, professional announcer here. Looks like he's staged to do his thing. So, Jeff, yeah, he was able to find Pablo, who's, you know, excellent professional here. So excited to have Pablo join the team here for the first time in the triumphant stage.
And let me take a moment and see if we can get the full fight card in. We're going to start out with Mackenzie Himes finding out Mason San Leandro taking on Kendra Lynn from Richard De La Reza's Mango Tree. The second bout up, Brian Tyler from Rudy Ott's Smash Fight Team taking Orlando Angulo from Danny Pinto's Danny Pinto Muay Thai out in Las Vegas. And then that takes us to that Hardware Awards. Brandon Kurosawa from Jesse Magnuson's Boxing Club out in San Diego taking on Philip Ignacio from Mesh. Also, that's a highlighted 5-round amateur fight, okay? Then we're going to give you one more pro fight on this free preview, all right? That's Yasmin Sahani from Boxing Club taking on Cynthia Garcia Flores from Richard Cruz, Mexico City. That's a professional fight, okay? And then that's it for the freebies. You're going to have to come in, buy it at $7.99, see the rest of these professional fights. Andrew Webb taking on Antonio Martinez. That's going to be a great fight. Hollywood Lance Dixon from Los Angeles Muay Thai taking on Nate Adams out of Oregon, Tongsan Muay Thai. And then UFC veteran Brendan Raftery taking on Benjamin Torres out of Rumor Moreno's Luz Fight Team out in Mexico. And then one of my girls, Magali Alvarez from Muay Thai America, taking on Aline Cruz Reyes from Richard Cruz's Muay Thai gym out in Mexico. And then the co-main event for the triumphant cruiserweight title, 5 rounds, Jacob Rodriguez from Heritage Muay Thai out of San Antonio, Texas, taking on Alberto Amaro, Demolition Fight Team in Tijuana. And then we're going to cap it off with that main event. All right, Zach Bunnell taking a fight on 5-day notice. 5-day notice, okay, against Jose Ruelas from Ludus Fight Team. And that is for the WMC, the World Muay Thai Council Intercontinental Belt. That is a great, great card for only $7.99.
Yeah, yeah. You know, in speaking of that cruiserweight title fight with Jacob Rodriguez and Alberto Amaro, interviewing Alberto yesterday, it was interesting. You always get the sense that the quiet ones are the scariest. And he was very quiet, and he didn't want to brag at all about himself. And I like to ask the question, you know, when you're tired, when you're, you know, you, the alarm clock wakes up, you know, you got to run, you got to go to the gym, you got to do whatever, and you don't want to do it. What's the thought in your head? Like, what drives you to continue to push through that exhaustion or those days where you just don't want to work? And he said, I'm here to earn my respect. That's all he said. He said, I said, so when you go in there to fight and, you know, you know, what's the thought in your head? He said, I am just there to earn respect. And that's a scary guy when, you know, he doesn't have these lofty ambitions. He doesn't see himself as this wonderfully carved statue. He's just a woodblock trying to do the best he can and earn his respect. You know, now, Kevin, you've had so many fights.
Oh. Take their seats.
Oh, well. Is that the voice of Jose Martinez letting us know that it's about time to get it started here, guys? I believe so.
Well, that means we got to strap our seatbelts on.
Yeah. Oh, no, what? I don't have a seatbelt. Here's our ring announcer, guys, to start this Triumphant 9. Pablo Flores, guys. He is ready to get it started. Here we go, Pablo.
From Honolulu, Hawaii, welcome, please welcome, Kendra Lynn.
Kendra Lynn making her way to the ring. Kendra Lynn 5-0, remember, coming from MMA, but she's been training Muay Thai for the last 2 years, so she is well equipped
for the task in front of her. But she does have a very difficult and experienced opponent. She says she's ready. She's fighting for all her people back in New York State, where she came from before she moved to Hawaii. She wants to display all the hard work she's put in with her coaches the last 2 years. When we asked her why do you do this? Why do you fight? She goes, I just like violence, David. And I know, Kevin, I know that's someone that you can appreciate right there.
You gotta love that. People that are comfortable in uncomfortable situations that cause most people to shut down, that's where they thrive, and then they look for violence, they look for pain, they look for hard work. That's a dangerous person when it comes to a fighter.
Definitely. Referee Bam Stell giving her the last minute instructions, making sure they're aware of the rules of this bout here. No shin guards, no headgear for these guys.
Looks like Pablo's going to call up the next fighter.
Oh, here we go.
Oh, man, I'm excited.
Right? It's been a long time coming, folks, but Triumphant 9 is here.
San Leandro, California, Mackenzie Himes.
Mackenzie Himes, they call her Mick Speedy. 4 years into Muay Thai, started out in softball, doing all kinds of different sports. She wrestled in high school. After 16 years of softball, she said, hey, I want to hit something other than softballs. 4-1, okay, 4 wins against 1 defeat U.S. MTO champion. She calls herself relentless. She needs to work, use her angles in and out. This is an opportunity for her. She wants to give a shout-out to her East Coast family, Mackenzie McSpeedy Hines.
Yes, we are excited. She makes her way. Several fighters here from Mace Gym scheduled to fight. Unfortunately, our very first fight with Adel Harada was scrapped because of those travel issues with his opponent, Preston Schrory. They were supposed to rematch a great bout that they had in the past, but we'll have to save that for another Triumphant, unfortunately for him. But definitely shout out to Adel. Let's take a look at the tail of the tape. Lynn, 5-0 record in MMA, 28 years old, 5'3", 130 pounds for this fight. We have Mackenzie Hines. She comes in with a 4-1 Muay Thai record. Couple years younger, 23 years old, also 5'3". Both looking to make a big impression their first time on the Triumphant stage.
All right, three keys here. So Kendra Lim's going to need to make that transition from MMA to Muay Thai. She talks about her clinch work. She's very comfortable about that. I see her using a lot of clinch work to try to smother out the technique. Mackenzie Himes, her technique here, she needs to be speedy, as she says. Use in and out angles. Use that footwork and confuse her opponent. That's going to be a great bout here. This is what they need to do to come out victorious. Yeah. And triumphant.
Triumphant. Yes, we got this bout scheduled for 3 2-minute rounds. This amateur rule Muay Thai fight. 10-point must system based on knockdowns, damage, effective strikes, and ring generalship. Punches, kicks, elbows, and knees are legal. They got those elbow pads on there because they are amateurs. 3 knockdown rules in effect. Elbows with pads only, as we mentioned. No knees to the head. But pretty much a full rules Muay Thai fight as you get.
And I want to add, we are in Mexico. 12-6 elbows are allowed. That downward elbow coming from the sky to the floor, that is allowed.
Is that just a time zone different thing? Is that why? Because we're in the,
from
no,
daylight savings time.
Yeah. Oh, got it. And Pablo Flores with our announcement.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are back and we are live. This is Triumphant number 9, presented by GoTV, Pharma Extracts, MuayThaiAddict.com. And it's all happening from sunny Rosarito Beach, Baja California, Mexico. This show is sanctioned by the Rosarito Boxing, Pro Wrestling, and MMA Commission, Chairman Antonio Lozada, Commissioner in Charge Victor Reveles, your physician in the ringside, Dr. Benjamin Sandoval, your three judges scoring this bout in ringside, David Holtz, Jose Covian, and Edgar Lopez, and your third man inside the ring to watch the actions, your referee in charge, Dan Snell. All right, Muay Thai fans, let's get ready for 3 2-minute rounds of Muay Thai action in the super featherweight division. Introducing first, the fighter standing in the blue corner. She wears blue trunks with orange and white. She officially weighs in 128 pounds. She stands with an outstanding professional record, 8 perfect one, 5 wins against no losses. She represents Mango Tree Gym, Honolulu, Hawaii. Here is Kendra Lynn. And her opponent across the ring, standing in the red corner. She wears white trunks with black trim. She officially weighs in 126 pounds. Her professional record stands at 4 victories against 1 lone defeat. She represents Mesh Striking Arts, San Leandro, California, USA. Please welcome Mackenzie Himes.
Just to clarify, this is actually an amateur bout. Neither of these girls
are. Now with the final instructions, your referee in charge, Dan Snell.
So there will be amateur rules here, guys.
What's up, ladies? Let's obey my commands at all times. Protect yourself at all times.
Touch gloves. One of the tell things that we know from an amateur and professional fight, you can see the elbow pads on our contestants here. Elbow pads, they are allowed to use all the elbows allowed, including the 12 to 6 elbows. Two minute rounds. 2 3-minute rounds. Here we go for round number one.
That's right. 3 2-minute rounds. They touch gloves. The girls, we have Lynn in the black shorts with the red gloves. You have Mackenzie Himes in the blue shorts. Already looking to use that movement is Himes. Himes in the blue gloves, clinching up with Lynn here. Again, Lynn comfortable in that clinch because of that MMA, she said. Throwing some nice knees, nice elbow, high kick. Looks like the clinch is where this fight's going to start here, guys.
Here we got some solid knees coming in from Kendra. She's looking to impose her will, grind her down.
And we expected this from her, Kevin. As she said, she does like the clinch. Often when you see those MMA fighters transition, it feels like a safe place because they've done so much wrestling.
Oh,
right?
Yeah. Yeah, you see a lot of big overhands right into the clinch and utilizing that as much as they can, trying to smother people, wear them down. And if you're not used to that clinch fighting, you can gas out immediately because you don't know how to breathe in there. You don't know how to work in there.
Oh, nice body kick from Lynn. And you see Himes is trying to get that footwork going. And she's going to need to stay out of those power shots and knees from Lynn coming forward.
Lynn is just moving forward, applying that pressure, using that push kick effectively. And nice left hook going through that kick.
Guys, you know, for our debut amateur fight at this card, look at these girls look so poised in there. You can really see their experience coming through.
Yeah, any ring experience is good ring experience, whether it's boxing, MMA, Muay Thai. It makes all the difference in the world whether you're able to stay composed in there.
Nice head kick. She's really following with that. After the clinch gets out, she's following that head kick. It's been effective a couple times, so you can see the nice elbows from Lynn.
Attack the body.
Mackenzie's really riding the ropes here. You can see she's having trouble trying to figure out angles to get in on Lynn right now, yeah?
Yeah, Kendra's really walking her down. Mackenzie's trying to use her movement, but Kendra's been able to kind of cut her off, single hard shots, and just walk through everything she's doing. And I think she's slowly breaking her down.
I like Kendra walking down, getting that clinch, powering the knees, using the elbows, and also striking right out of the clinch. She had an effective high kick coming out from that break, and she's doing really, really well. Mackenzie Himes hasn't really quite figured out her rhythm yet. She uses the push kick, but there's not enough heat to stop Kendra moving forward. It's going to be a tough one. If you were in the corner of Mackenzie, Kevin, what would you say to her?
Well, she's doing a lot of, I would say, unnecessary movement. You know, a lot of times with movers, it works great if somebody's biting on your feints, if it's changing up the rhythm and the tempo. But Kendra's been able to walk through everything she's doing.
All right, Kevin, we have a replay. Call this.
Beautiful head kick from
yep.
Kendra. But Mackenzie's, you know, she's staying composed, even though Kendra's walking her down. But I feel like the tides were starting to turn there a little more towards the end for Kendra.
Yeah, the pressure that Lynn is putting on Mackenzie in the blue gloves here, it seems really difficult to deal with. And we'll see if Mackenzie can change her tactics. Big elbows in the corner over here, boys. You can hear them hitting. Even with those elbow pads, those are massive elbows. You can already see the redness start to begin to form on the face of Mackenzie Himes there. Looks like she's throwing some shots a little bit out of desperation here.
Yeah, everything Kendra's doing is done with bad intentions. And Mackenzie feels that even just with her pressure and her presence. That can make you break down.
Kenzie circling. She's but still looks has an eye of looking to land her shot. She doesn't look like she's overwhelmed, but she looks like she is having trouble finding a way to get in on Lynn here in this amateur bout, this opening bout.
Yeah, it's tough when somebody's walking you down like that, throwing singles and double hard shots. You almost tend to want to do the same thing with them, but that's not the way you fight. So you kind of want to get back to your numbers, get back to your movement. But that, I think that's what she's having a little bit of difficulty with. She's trying to play the same game.
I like Kendra. She's very balanced. You know, even when she misses, she's good timing, and she's able to kick and strike from almost any direction. And that footwork of McKenzie, maybe moving a little bit too much. She's tying up her feet and not able to strike because of that movement.
That's right. Now you push it into the corner here. She's really, just you can see is physically stronger than Himes here in this fight. And she's really starting to take advantage of that strength and wear her down. But she's not, oh, nice deep to the face there from McKenzie. Maybe she's going to start to earn some respect here of Lynn. But, you know, Lynn just looks like she's having a walk in the park here. And it's really not troubling her any of the shots coming from Himes at all.
Yeah, McKenzie's got to do something to give Kendra pause. She's just walking through everything she's doing, not even caring about what's coming at her, and that's not a great place to be when you're on the other end of that.
Yeah, that is not a good look, and she could kind of start to see the wear and tear forming on the body and the face of McKenzie. McSpeedy Himes, Kendra Lynn looks like it's just another day at the office here. Really, for amateur fighters, you know, and again, Triumphant always puts on great, you know, great fights with, you know, great competition. And, you know, Himes is having trouble finding her way in. She's definitely not out of this, you know, but she is definitely not able to execute the game plan I think she came in here with, which is to use her movement and counter effectively.
Well, I want to see her movement combined with strikes. You know, I want to see combos from her. I want her to see her make Kendra think up and down, mix some leg kicks, use some hooks, mix it up and down, so she has to think defensively, because right now Kendra is only thinking offensively. Right now McKenzie needs to do something to earn some respect, throw her timing off, and make Kendra think a little bit of defense.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is round number 3, your final round.
Here we go, third and final round. Girls touch gloves, you know, fighters never out of it. We'll see. You know, it seems at this point that McKenzie's going to have to finish her opponent to win this fight. Even winning this round likely is not going to be enough to win on the judges' scorecard. So we'll see if she's going to go for broke. But, you know, when you go for broke, Kevin, you put yourself in some precarious situations.
Yeah, I do. But, you know, if you're going to lose anyway, you might as well
go for
swinging.
It. Yep.
Well, she can score a knockdown. She can make this fight a draw. She can get a 10-8 round and even out the fight. So she's not out of it right now. She's looking strong. She's looking with intensity.
Yeah, sometimes when a fight's so one-sided like that, like, you'll see what kind of fighter that person is. Do they just break and let themselves lose, or do they fight anyway knowing they're going to lose on points anyhow, but they refuse to give up? And that really shows you a lot of what the fighter's made of.
All right, just a small timeout for our wardrobe malfunction.
Equipment issue, yeah. Much respect for Lynn, just kind of saw what was going on and stepped back and let her opponent kind of fix her wardrobe there. Oh, that corner's probably not a good place for McKenzie Himes, though. Yes, David?
Himes has a really, really, I mean, sorry, Kendra Lynn has a very nice high kick, and she doesn't lean back, and it just almost comes out of nowhere.
Oh, you're really starting to see the shots kind of produce the redness on the face of McKenzie Himes here. But, man, I have not seen her eyes. Well, until then, I haven't seen her eyes really turn away. But you just see the power of Lynn coming forward. It's tough for Himes to keep up. She's given everything she's got, though. You got to give her credit for the heart she's displaying here in the triumphant ring today.
She's losing a little bit of a rhythm.
That high kick is brushed by several times. Yeah. I feel like if that lands shin to temple, that could be good night for McKenzie. Good movement there. 10 seconds left here in this opening bout. Triumphant 9 here in Rosarito, Baja California. Oh, big shot still getting exchanged to the very end, and that is it. That's going to be the end of our very first fight. Guys, I mean, it's a way
to open this card.
Right?
What a way!
It's a pretty obvious scorecard victory, it looks like, for Kendra Lynn. But we will have to go to the judges' scorecards for the official decision. You got the corner of McKenzie Himes hugging her, you know, so proud of the effort she put forth here today. But I don't think it's going to be enough to take out
the really, really strong and aggressive Kendra Lin.
Well, I've said it many times, one thing more exciting than a Muay Thai fight is a female Muay Thai fight, because they fight every second of every round, and this was one of them. They were just nonstop.
Yeah, and you know, even though Mackenzie wasn't winning the rounds, she was always trying. She didn't give up. You know, and that in itself is an enormous victory, particularly when you're an amateur. It lets you know, like, do you want to do this or not, whether it's going your way or somebody else's.
All right, let's take a look at some of the action. Kevin, call it as you see it.
Good inside leg kick. Kendra was doing a great job of stopping Mackenzie's movement. When she was moving, she'd do those inside leg kicks. She tried to teep her, but she wasn't planted enough to cause Kendra to hesitate on anything. She just walked her down.
That's right. God, Kendra never really looked like she had to sprint at all through this fight. You know, she just keep calm, composed, walking forward, throwing shots, not overthrowing shots. Mm-hmm. She didn't get thirsty for the knockout. Yeah. Just kind of ran her game. And man, I really am impressed. First time seeing Kendra Lin in the triumphant ring. I'm really impressed with her performance, guys.
And first time doing a Muay Thai fight. She's transitioning from MMA, 5-0 in MMA. So it looks like we have a decision.
We're going to the decision right now.
All right, and coming up next, we have Brian Tyler taking on Orlando Anguillo, and that's a great fight coming up. And that's going to follow this one right now as we await the official decision for Mackenzie Himes and Kendra Lin.
And ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds of Muay Thai action, we now go to the judges' scorecards. Judge Dave Holtz, he scores in 29-28. And both judges, Jose Cobian and Edgar Lopez, they have the same scores of 30-27 for your winner by the way of unanimous decision. From Honolulu, Hawaii, Kendra Lin.
Now, we pretty much decided the final outcome of the fight. Interesting that one of the judges gave
and
one
also
of the rounds
big
to
round of
Mackenzie.
Applause for her opponent.
Yeah, that surprised
from San Leandro,
a lot.
California, Mackenzie Himes.
But, you know, maybe you saw something different from a different angle. You know, sometimes we forget that each side of the ring shows you a different fight, and some things are very clear to one side and not the other.
Well, congratulations, Kendra Lin, taking on her Muay Thai debut with the V for victory. She stands triumphant in this, making her Muay Thai debut after coming off 5-0 in mixed martial arts. She comes out victorious. Kendra Lin representing Richard De La Reyes' Mango Tree Gym. Congratulations, Kendra Lin.
Yeah, and you know what? Can I give a shout-out, too? She's an Air Force E6 in the Air Force. You know, we just had Veterans Day last week. So I just want to thank her and everyone in the armed forces and in the military services that volunteer their time to protect our country. And, you know, big shout-out to her and everyone involved in the armed forces and all the veterans that have served us. Got to thank them for sure. Looks like we are going to Pablo Flores, and we are ready to introduce the next fight here.
And our next fight, Orlando Anguillo. All right. Anguillo, sorry. All right. 30 years old, 10 years in the Muay Thai business. He's excited to come out here. Got his influence watching Chaz Mokey and the man next to me, Kevin Ross. Calls himself a balanced fighter. 5 wins against 1 defeat. Taking on Danny Pinto Muay Thai, taking on, go ahead.
Taking on Brian Tyler, you know, a smash gym. You know, we've seen a lot of Rudy Ott's guys on here. And when I always call them their Swiss Army knives fighters. They always have their well-polished skills on all levels.
From San Jose,
so we'll
California, USA, Brian Tyler.
And that's who I was just speaking about. That's Brian Tyler. He's making his way to the triumphant ring right now. Rudy Ott and, you know, looks like Daniel Compton is going to corner him as well. And Daniel Compton is a successful MMA fighter and got a great corner in his corner here today. Very experienced corner. First time seeing Brian myself. So we'll see. He said he started watching K1 when he was a kid. And all the greats of K1 inspired him. And even though he started watching kickboxing and that's what got him into the sport, he says he's a Muay Thai traditionalist.
He likes the traditional style, you know. He kind of gets his march going forward, and he says look forward to him displaying those traditional Muay Thai skills in the triumphant ring today.
Brian Tyler coming in with a record of 4 wins against 4 defeats, even on that record, to see if he can bring himself onto the positive side, on the upside of that record. He's had a lot of great fights. He's a fan of Giorgio Petrosian.
And from Las Vegas, Nevada, let's meet USA, his opponent. Orlando Angulo.
That's right, and Orlando Angulo coming out. And we've seen Danny Pinto. He took on Andrew Capurro for, I think it was T7 or T6 in Las Vegas. So, very skilled Muay Thai fighter himself. Opened a gym in Las Vegas recently. He trains out of there. Danny Pinto's here cornering him in this fight. He's 5-1 as an amateur, so has a wealth of experience there, a little bit more experience, or a little bit better, I should say, record and experience in amateur Muay Thai. So we will see. He takes Kevin as an inspiration, someone he grew up watching, so we'll see if he says he's that type of fighter as well. He's a come-forward fighter. He's aggressive. He's looking to hurt his opponent. And so we'll see if that's going to come to fruition here against Brian Tyler today.
Well, Orlando fighting out of the blue corner, which he is actually a sponsor of, okay? Pharma Extract, his own corner. He's sponsoring his own corner. Great, great shout-out for that. Fighting out of your own corner, if your own company.
Yeah, creates CBD extracts and different balms and healing agents here. And so exciting as these guys seal the ring. David, tell the fans at home that might not understand what's going on right now as these fighters seal the ring.
Well, the fighters walk around each corner and they tap each of the corner pads. And they are sealing off the ring to keep good luck in the ring and also not allow bad luck coming into the ring.
Let's go to the tail of the tape, guys. We have Brian Tyler. He's got a 4-4 record. Angulo, a 5-1, just 1 defeat record. 2 years difference, 32 for Tyler, 30 for Orlando Angulo. Angulo has a 1-inch height advantage over Tyler. This is a 3-round amateur fight, so it will be 2-minute rounds, 3 2-minute rounds. Again, these amateurs, as you said, they go 2 minutes, but they pack 3 minutes worth in. And we'll take it to Pablo Flores.
Ladies and gentlemen, triumphant number 9 is proud to present our next bout set for 3 2-minute rounds of Muay Thai action in the super welterweight division. Your 3 judges scoring this bout in ringside: Joshua Ferraro, David Holtz, Jose Cobian, and Edgar Lopez. Your referee in charge of the action, JJ Ferraro. Introducing first, the fighter standing in the Pharma Extract blue corner. He wears white trunks with blue and gold. He officially weighs in 150.8 pounds. He stands with a professional record of 2 wins against no losses. He represents Pinto Muay Thai Gym, Las Vegas, Nevada, USA. Please welcome Orlando Angulo. And his opponent across the ring, standing in the GoTV red corner. He wears black trunks with red and white. He officially weighs in 148.2 pounds. And this afternoon, he's making his pro debut. Hailing out of Smash Fight Team San Jose, California, USA, here is Brian Tyler.
And again, folks, unfortunately for Pablo,
and now with the final instructions, your referee in charge, JJ Ferraro.
Pablo likes Zach, short notice, a comment or a ring announcer here, so some of his information might be a little
incorrect. All right, we've already been over the amateur rules. I expect a clean, fair fight. Protect yourself at all times and always obey my commands. Touch gloves.
Well, that was corrected by our referee, JJ Ferraro, talking about that we are fighting amateur rules. 2-minute rounds, 3 of them, fighters using elbow pads. 12 to 6 elbows are allowed. Here we go for round number 1.
We are here, Triumphant 9, our second fight here. Rosarito, Baja California, guys. We are looking at Brian Tyler in the red gloves. Oh, they're trading sweeps already. Orlando Angulo in the blue gloves, guys. 150-pound match here. We'll see. Got the southpaw. Brian Tyler says always loves southpaws. Trains with Sean Climaco. He's a triumphant champion, actually, at 130 pounds. And so says I got a lot of work in with him, and I learned a lot from him. So we'll see if all that work with Climaco can transfer into a similar success in the triumphant ring. Boys catching kicks, trading sweeps so far. Nice inside leg kick from Angulo.
The fighter's trying to measure to get that distance in. It seems like they were fighting with brooms because we saw a lot of sweeps going on in that
first.
Yeah,
right? I mean, at least you know the floor is clean.
Yeah, it was both very beautiful kicks from Brian, but Orlando was able to catch them, sweep them off his feet, and kind of mitigate the action there. You see the Petrosian influence on Brian. It's southpaw, it helps. And he's just very composed, looking for single hard shots.
That's what he said. He's a real traditionalist and, really composed in there. You know, Angulo aggressive. You can see him start to warm up a little bit, start to push forward, pushes Tyler into the corner of his own red corner there. Oh, nice high kick, though, trying to get off the ropes. Whoa, almost went over the top there. No luchadoring here, guys. I know we're in Mexico, but... Oh, yeah. Nice, got both legs with that kick. That round feels like it's going really fast with these guys because they're just throwing. Guys working for dominating clinch position, and that is the end of the first round, guys. What did you think about that first round, David?
Man, that is very even round. They both came in with sweeps. They both came in good body kicks, and they're using their techniques, and they're also keeping their composure right now. There's no slugging. There's no wild shots going on. You know what? It's so hard to score that first round.
Yeah, Kevin, what are your thoughts? Kevin, what would you give it to if you were having to judge this fight? I mean, that was a tough one. That was back and forth.
I refuse to judge fights. But, yeah, that was very, very even. It just kind of depends on who you give a little more credit to. But you could have an argument for both guys.
It's way, nice. way to stay I love that neutral. That I'm putting you in the hot seat, and you're able to just cool it off.
What
so
I do like to see is the amateurs have the composure in the skills of the pros, and that was something when I was coming up that was so important to us is to show that high level regardless of whether you're amateur or not.
And look at that beautiful view out there, fighting on the beach, the pier behind us, Rosarito Beach, for Triumphant 9. I like to call this Triumphant International. Here we go for round number two.
Beautiful ooh, trade kicks again. Oh, nice little left hand, sneaky over the top left hand lands for Tyler. But man, it almost seemed to wake up Angulo a bit here. Sometimes, you got fighters that almost need to get hit before they really start fighting. Angulo appears that might be one of those guys.
Yeah, for sure.
But Tyler pushing Angulo back now into his red corner.
And when they stand, it's almost like a tennis match of Muay Thai. They are rallying with techniques back and forth. Great action here.
Very composed, both fighters. Different rhythms, obviously, in beats. Angulo more of a bounce in and out. You see, as Tyler described, he was very more, marching forward, looking for that good, clean shot. Super composed, nice low kick. Oh, but Angulo answers with a low kick himself.
Yeah, Tyler's doing a great job landing those kicks, but Orlando's always answering back.
Answer right back, right?
That's what's making this contest so even.
Two, three leg kicks in a row from Angulo. Tyler looking like he might be trying to get that his hands more involved in this fight right now. Ooh, nice inside leg kick. That's always tough with the southpaw, right? Because that power inside leg kick that they're throwing, both of them have it,
True.
But when you fight a southpaw, you're not used to getting that power kick inside, and it can kind of deter. You see the bruising on the inside of the left leg of Angulo already. Those dark purple bruises look like Angulo might be starting to fade a little bit.
Orlando's landing really hard kicks, and you can kind of feel his energy going a little bit and his willingness to stay engaged.
Yeah, you do see him step back, almost the anger or the focus starting to turn a little bit to frustration.
Huge elbow over the top.
Beautiful elbow. And again, as I mentioned, as they made their way to the ring, Rudy Ott's guys always seem to be pretty well polished in all eight limbs. Tyler's doing a good job using punches, kicks, elbows. We'll see just missing the knees here. Maybe start getting close in that clinch as Angulo tires out a little bit. Maybe start to try to dominate and clinch you some knees here. Kevin, what does Angulo got to do to change the tide of this fight?
It's kind of like the last fight. Tyler's starting to just walk him down, land hard shots. And Angulo is trying to use a little more numbers, but he's not giving – Tyler, much reason to pause or to hesitate.
David, got a replay going on. What are you seeing here?
Oh, these guys are rallying with that leg kick, and I see that hook coming over the top there. He's using high and low angles, and he's really setting the pace there. Just beautiful elbow that just comes right over the top there.
Yeah, he's starting to really open it up here as this beautiful aerial shot here of Baja California. So we go into our third and final round of the second amateur fight here. 3 2-minute rounds scheduled for this fight if it goes the distance. Another nice inside leg kick from Tyler.
And fight fans, if you're watching this under the free preview, it's not too late to order the pay-per-view on Facebook Triumphant Combat Sports page for $7.99. Beautiful punching
nice,
coming right
there's
through.
Those knees. Oh, looks like Angulo might be hurt. Goes for a spin now. And I noticed something. I saw Tyler throw a hard inside leg kick. Angulo checked it with the knee. I saw Tyler look down at his leg right away like, you know, like, oh, you don't feel it in the fight. But I have a funny feeling that when we see him after the fight, he might be doing a little pimp walk.
That is the pros and cons of that inside leg kick. If you land it, it's great. But if it gets checked, it's not so great.
Yeah. Oh, Angulo's looking like he is fading a little bit here. And Tyler is feeling that and putting the pressure on right now.
Yeah, he's got that sense that he's breaking him down. He's hoping to get him out of there. Take
he's
the judge out of this.
Scoring really well with the punches, too. And then transitioning to the elbows, too.
Another nice inside leg kick. So maybe, you know, obviously his leg's not affected too bad from that hard check earlier in the round. Angulo, two big elbows. Oh, Angulo goes down. You could tell he was starting to fade, and the referee starts the count.
JJ tells something to the neutral corner. You have to report to the neutral corner. You have it's a mandatory 8 count. He's coming up. That's going to be a 10-8 round.
Only a 2-minute round. There's not a lot of time left. I wonder if Tyler can do what it takes to put Angulo out of here. Angulo's looking. He's a little worse for wear. Angulo goes down on his own. I think Angulo's exhausted, guys.
Yeah, he's tired.
20
mentally
seconds.
And physically.
And there's just very little time on this clock now. 20 seconds. He is down for the second time. That's going to make
here
it
you
a
go. Got about 8 seconds. Let's see if Tyler, you know he's coming for that finish right now. Oh, he gives him a look like, whoa, big left hook, big elbow. Wow, great third round from Brian Tyler.
Yeah, and scoring 2 knockdowns, that's going to give him a 10-7 round. It looks like it's going to sway the direction of Brian Tyler.
You know, yeah, that was a great early effort from Angulo. But as you were saying, Kevin, you know, that economy of energy. He put a lot of power in those kicks early, and it didn't seem like he had enough juice to get through all 3 rounds. You know, luckily for Angulo, he's got plenty of CBD oil probably back home that he can rub on those sore legs when he's all said and done.
Yeah, and that's the thing about Muay Thai, though. You're hurt no matter whether you win or lose. It's a painful sport.
Yeah, I tell people, I say, you know, even when you win a fight, you can hurt yourself really bad.
Yeah.
So, you know, especially, you know, in the street, you want to try to avoid that. In the ring, though, it's kind of unavoidable. You know, like I said, that hard check Angulo gave Tyler, probably going to hurt them both. Let's take a look at those knockdowns real quick, David. What are you seeing here?
Oh, a knockdown. He's marching forward right there, and he comes in, and you can see Angulo's hands a little bit tired.
Left.
Yeah.
Kept breaking down those legs.
Just a beautiful elbow over the top.
Faded down. And Kevin, it looks like we're going to go to the second knockdown here where he just kind of fell down. Is that just happen sometimes?
Yeah, and you know, a lot of that is just mental fatigue as well as physical. You're kind of over it.
Yeah, you're looking for a way out, but credit to Angulo, he could have just stayed down,
true.
But he got up knowing that Tyler was probably going to come with a fury to try to finish him.
Mm-hmm.
So great heart, great display right there. You knew he was going to be tough, but I didn't have the skills to pay the bills here today.
Yeah, and sometimes that's the win in itself, just not refusing to quit.
You learn a lot about yourself when you display that kind of heart.
Let's take a look at that second knockdown again. And he's coming right in there, going to that clinch. And he was just fading away, just fading away.
You could see exhaustion as he exhales after he falls.
Yeah,
he
caught him with that good straight left and then the elbow over the top. I think both of those together is what added to it.
Let's send it to Pablo Flores for the official decision.
Ladies and gentlemen, after 3 rounds of Muay Thai action, we now go to the judges' scorecards. Judge Dave Holtz, he scores it 30-25. And judges Edgar Lopez and Jose Cobian had the same scores of 29-26. For your winner, by the way, of unanimous decision, Smash Fight Team San Jose, California, Brian Tyler.
Pretty much what we expected, guys. Brian Tyler takes this unanimous decision victory over Orlando Angulo.
And fight fans, if you are enjoying the fights, this is our second amateur fight. We have two more fights on the free preview. It is not too late to order that Facebook pay-per-view. Only $7.99. You will see a tremendous card up ahead, including all the professional fights. We will also give you one preview of a professional bout. But before that happens, we have what I call Hardware Wars. Hardware Wars coming up. That is our next fight. It's a five-rounder, Philip Ignacio from A Striking System taking on Brando Kurosawa. And I said before, these fighters have seven belts between them. And that's why I call it Hardware Wars. These guys are so poised, so technical. This is going to be a great fight, but you're going to see this happen in five rounds instead of three.
Yeah, with these guys, you know, you could you could put a Taylor's kids through college making a pants with 12-inch belt loops to fit all these belts that they have. But we will not have a belt on the line, but pride is on the line. You know, you got two guys who are both champions in several different organizations coming here clashing tonight on the triumphant stage. And, you know, both these guys, you know, not, again, as we mentioned earlier, probably won't be amateurs much longer. Chances are next time we see them on the triumphant stage, they will be professionals. So this might be kind of the last amateur hurrah for either of these guys. Excited to see how this one's going to turn out.
Well, Philip Ignacio, 20 wins against 5 defeats. That's 25
from
amateur
San
fights
Leandro,
to his
California,
name.
USA, Philip Ignacio.
And as Pablo Flores introduces Philip Ignacio, once again, he is a fighter with 25 fights to his name, 20 wins against 5 defeats. He's the Bay Area Challenge champion. He's also the North American IKF champion 2 times. He's the Iowa TBA champion. This guy out here is very technical. He has a lot of wealth of experience, but that's not to say he's going against somebody like Brandon Kurosawa. 13 wins against 1 defeat and 1 draw. He, too, also holds an IKF championship title, including the WCK and the IFS title. This one is going to be a banger.
That's right. We saw Philip Ignacio on a previous triumphant card. He took Jake Haas on for a Bay Area Challenge amateur title. Haas was streaking with 2 knockouts in triumphant before he met Ignacio. I'm not going to lie. I assumed that Haas was going to do what he does
San
to everybody.
Diego,
and
California.
Ignacio took him out in 5 rounds.
Brandon Kurosawa.
But he has got a task in front of him, David, you know.
Brandon Kurosawa fighting out the boxing club out in San Diego. This guy is a steady fighter, technically very, very clean. I've seen him in some wars, and he's never lost his composure, never lost his technique, never lost his style. He stays in. He listens to his coaches. This fighter is on point, and I'm going to see a technical war.
13-1-1 amateur record. These guys fighting under 147-pound rules. Kurosawa coming in 146.5. 145.5 for Philip Ignacio, guys. Excited about this highlighted amateur fight. 5 rounds, 2 minutes each round. Again, it's got the same rules as we had in the last previous 2 fights. You're going to have all your weapons at your avail except knees to the head. That will be the only weapon that you are not allowed to use. And we are excited to get it started here.
We'll send it to Pablo Flores for the official introduction. Both of our fighters for this 5-round amateur event.
Ladies and gentlemen, Triumph number 9 is proud to present our next bout set for 5 2-minute rounds of Muay Thai action in the welterweight division. Your 3 judges going this bout in ringside. Dave Holes, Jose Covian, and Edgar Lopez. And your referee in charge of the action, Dan Snell. Introducing to you first, the fighter standing in the Pharma Extracts blue corner. He wears the black trunks with white trim. He officially weighs in 145.8 pounds in 25 professional bouts. He stands with 20 victories against 5 losses. He represents MASH Striking Arts from San Leandro, California, USA. Here is Philip Ignacio. And his opponent across the ring standing in the GoTV red corner. He wears gray trunks with red trim. He officially weighs in 146.8 pounds. in 15 professional bouts. He stands with 13 victories against one defeat and one draw. He represents the boxing club, San Diego, California, USA, Brandon Kurosawa. And now with the final instructions, your referee in charge, Dan Snell. Five rounds.
This bout is scheduled for five two-minute rounds. We have Philip Ignacio taking on Brandon Kurosawa. These guys have both have been on the USA National Muay Thai team. I expect a banger in this one, but I expect a lot of great technique, a lot of composure. Smooth Muay Thai.
All right, Sam, could you give me that salute?
Let's take a look at the stats of these fighters right now.
And we're going to go to the tail of the tape. Philip Ignacio, 16-3 amateur record versus Kurosawa's 13-1-1. Ignacio, 26, a couple years younger, is Kurosawa at 23. A couple inches height advantage for Ignacio at 5'10 to Kurosawa's 5'8. Again, this is a five-round fight.
And the keys for these fighters to be triumphant, Philip Ignacio actually has 25 fights, and he's got these fight wins because of a reason. He needs to keep his style, keep his pace. Brandon Kurosawa, he's been in through some wars. He's always kept that steadiness. He's always kept his game plan. Both these fighters, if they never deviate from their game plan, it will be a war of attrition.
Here we go, guys. 10-point must system. You guys know how we do this here. Three knockdown rule. Fighter gets knocked down three times, and the fight will be called. And here we go. We got that teep. Ignacio using that length so far. Kurosawa looking like he's just trying to get a read on what Ignacio's doing here.
If you're not familiar with Muay Thai, teep is known as that push kick. It's that front style kick that comes forward, sets the distance, also measures for timing. Teep in Thai is for that push kick.
There you go. And he's using that lead, that front teep, a lot here to just kind of keep Kurosawa at that longer distance. Nice outside leg kick. Kurosawa answers back with a switch kick. Caught by Ignacio on the ropes, turns off, throws that right hook. Oh, tries to catch it again. You got to be careful reaching down, right, for those low kicks, though.
Yeah,
right,
you also got to be careful of that big right hand coming back at your head. Sometimes when people catch kicks, the kicker tends to relax too much, and then they're wide open for that big counter. So both sides, you got to be careful.
Yeah, but both sides looking like they are just kind of a feel-out round here. Again, these are some high-level amateurs here. You're not going to see them just go crazy. Nice right hand from Ignacio, but good left hand from Kurosawa.
Yeah, Brandon's doing what he normally does, trying to walk him down and break him. But Phillip's doing a really good job with just a little bit of movement, not too much, just the right amount, making Brandon have to guess his range.
Yeah, and he's having a good time catching kicks here. It looks like Ignacio kind of using the full ring, you know, using lots of footwork and movement, the lateral movement here, to keep Kurosawa kind of off balance. No, there it is again, caught the kick through that right hand like you were mentioning, Kevin.
Yeah, it's great that he's catching the kicks, but he hasn't been able to do anything with them, so he's still taking the score and the impact of those
Absolutely,
kicks.
Absolutely, yeah.
So if you're not going to do something with it, you're better off letting those go.
Kurosawa, just determination on his eyes. You can't really take that look out of his gaze here of coming forward. Tries to go for a dump here. Ropes catches Ignacio, though. And that is the end of our very first round, guys. It was a very technical. It was a good feel-out round. It looked like both guys were able to score. Tough round to score as well.
Yeah, we've actually had these similar matchups so far tonight. The walk forward power striker against a little bit more of a mover. These guys are a little bit closer together than the other ones, which were like polar opposites. But we got Phillip being a little more agile and moving, and Brandon's looking just to like thump on him.
Yeah, he's got that look in his eyes like he's just, you know, wants to hurt him. And Ignacio, though, is a great counterfighter, as we saw when he fought Jake Haas on previous triumphants. And so we're excited to go into the second round here.
All right, let's take a look at some of that action from that first round. Kevin, call it as you see it.
Well, Brandon did a good job missing that overhand right and then going right into the clinch to kind of neutralize. He went for the dump here, but the rope saved Phillip.
Here we go for round number two. Brandon Kurosawa is still marching forward.
Yeah, I'd like to see Brandon throw a little more feelers out there, the jab, inside low kick. We've actually been working on that a lot because he does tend to get a little emotional and just want to walk through everything. There we go. Good body kick. Big, big body kick.
Man, it looks like the feeling out is done here, guys. And Kurosawa nice. Is coming to do more than feel. He's doing a touch here.
Yeah, it's always interesting to see guys right before they – I mean, both these guys can go pro whenever they're ready to. And this is a very high-level matchup. Good amateur experience from both guys. Nice turn and dump from Brandon.
Ooh, the heat, it's heating up right now in this second round, though. Kurosawa coming forward. Kurosawa in the blue gloves, taking on Ignacio in the red gloves. And you can see Brandon Kurosawa really start to put the pressure on. Checks the kick from Ignacio.
Good body kick.
Another good body kick. Ignacio didn't catch that one, just ate it all the way. Caught that one, and there goes that right hand you were talking about, trying to deter those kicks. But I just don't see Kurosawa, guys, as a guy who gets deterred very easily.
No. No, the biggest problem Brandon has had, and something we've been working on, is just not being mindless about it. Like, you know you can take it. That doesn't mean you should. Use his ability, use his range, and not jam himself up so much just because he really wants to kill all the time.
He just wants to hurt you.
Yeah.
That's the thing.
He's a very emotional fighter, and if you're going to be a professional, you got to be able to use your brain as well.
Very humble kid is Kurosawa. We asked, well, you know, what you want to do with your future after Muay Thai. He said, I'd love to coach, but I don't know if I'm worthy. Only if I become a good enough fighter will I allow myself to coach, he said, in that kind of mindset.
Well, he is one of the hardest workers I've ever seen. He has the mindset to make it as far as he wants to. He's always working. He's always in the gym. He's always improving on his weaknesses and sharpening up his strengths.
There we go, the end of round number two, and Philip Ignacio is taking a little bit more heat than that first round.
Yeah.
Seems like Kurosawa's really trying to turn it up on him. David, what would you tell Ignacio in his corner right now to do to kind of neutralize that pressure here in the third round?
Well, Philip, I think he's doing really good. He's using his footwork, but, you know, Brandon is actually imposing power, and he's making Philip think a little bit of defense because the things that Brandon is throwing, he's throwing with a lot of heat, so even if he's blocking it or he's eating it, he's feeling it, you know, and is making him think defensively. So Philip needs to let loose a little bit more, earn some respect from Brandon, let him know that he can hit with some power too, to try to neutralize that forwardness, that aggressiveness from Brandon.
And as you said, Kevin, sometimes pulling back Brandon is the hardest part,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, which is what I would like to see him just a little bit, not getting too aggressive, because he'll come in a little too hard and he'll end up in the clinch situation and jamming himself up, where he could just hold back a little bit and land really good, crisp shots.
As we saw in that replay, Kurosawa coming forward, another heavy leg kick from Kurosawa. Looks like Phillips' corner, little bit of a fire under him here, because he has a little bit more intensity coming out of this third round, guys.
Well, Phillips always going to grab those kicks, and Brandon can use that against them. It's like if you know every time somebody's going to grab a kick, it's very easy to come up with – change the kick or come with a punch after the fact.
Well, yeah, and I was wondering, you know, when someone reaches down to catch a low kick, you think, you know, you fake that low kick, it's, and yeah, coming up high is always a –
it can be a bad idea.
Yeah. Again, we have Kurosawa in the blue gloves. There's that high kick. Ignacio in the red gloves. Ignacio trying to fend off the forward pressure of Kurosawa here in the third round of this five-round highlighted amateur fight. We'll see if he can do what it takes here, but Kurosawa looking relentless. Nice left-right hand combination.
Movement.
Oh, the kick to the punch. Really starting to put it together now, guys. Make some
Kurosawa, no fear. He is just marching forward. The intensity in his eyes.
Yeah, I mean, but the good thing is he's not being reckless about it. He's finding that balance between being forward and aggressive, but still being defensively sound.
Absolutely. Yeah. He has that confidence underneath him right now, too.
Yeah.
And he's also changing the pace up, too. He's walking him down, and then he'll take a step back and kind of just hold his ground for a moment.
Well, as you said, he's kind of an all gas, no brakes guy, but he's learning how to pump the brakes a little bit.
Change the gears. Yeah. You don't got to pump the brakes. You got to have different gears, though.
Just let off the gas every now and then and then hit the sprints.
Fortunately, I have the same problem, so I've been able to convey some of these lessons I've learned over the years about that.
If he's going to listen to anybody about that kind of advice, it's going to be you, Kevin. Nice right hand from Ignacio, though. But, you know, again, Kurosawa, I haven't seen him blink one time.
Yeah. And that's such a huge factor, too. It's not just about whether you get hit or not, but it's how you take it, what you show. Whether the opponent or even the judges realize whether you're hurt or not.
I like to see Phillip take that fight a little bit inside in the clinch and actually test out that clinch of Brandon, because maybe he needs to do that to smother that forwardness, that power of Brandon Kurosawa.
Yeah, and we'll see. You know, it looked like when they got close before, Kurosawa was kind of able to dominate with more strength in the clinch. Mm-hmm. So maybe that's deterring Ignacio from trying to clinch more.
Yeah.
But, you know, at this point, I don't think the fight's working out in his favor. So it might be time to switch tactics and try something else.
Yeah, something the legend Ronnie Green told me years and years ago. Let's see this replay real quick.
Again, there's that forward pressure there.
Good left kick from Brandon and evasion.
Yeah, he's really putting it all together right now.
And I like the fact that Brandon, when he gets his kick caught, he knows a punch is coming and he just darts out of the way. So he's read that pattern already.
Yeah, I was saying about the advice Ronnie Green gave me. He's like, you got the guy in front of you, and sometimes you're so distracted by him, you forget that you have to convince these three judges that you are always winning this fight, regardless of what is or is not happening in there. And your composure, your balance, your energy can change the tides, and it's not just solely about who's getting hit.
Well, and then that's the coin term, a ring generalship,
yes,
here,
sir.
That comes with experience and some good coaching.
Yeah, some of the best advice I've ever heard, and unfortunately it was very early in my career.
And look at the Kurosawa, more of the same, forward pressure, heavy kicks.
Doing a good job not jamming himself up, though, keeping just the right amount of distance, the right amount of pressure. That's giving Phillip a little bit of panic, but not overwhelming himself. So Brandon's able to think while Phillip's more on the defense and trying to catch something.
Yeah, Phillip is definitely respecting the power of Brandon's kicks.
See, now, Phillip, try to get into that clinch like you suggested, David, but it seems like Kurosawa just has a little bit of a strength advantage when it comes to it. So.
Oh, strength and technique. You know, it's about your balance and your leverage. It's not always about who's stronger in there.
And this is a great bout. This is a technical chess match. It really, really is.
Beautiful left kick. Yeah, I'd love to see these guys go at it again in the pro circuit.
And I have a feeling with this type of fight they will. We'll see. Ooh, nice left-right combination. Does it again.
Yeah, nice.
Another
body
nice
kick.
Body kick from Kurosawa. Kurosawa really starting to feel it. Ignacio still can't find the answer to get this guy off of him.
Yeah, Ignacio's been landing that right hand, but he's not able to follow up with anything else. So even though he's catching him, it's just not too little too late.
And it's not a strong enough right hand to make Kurosawa back off the right hand alone.
Right. It almost actually gives him confidence.
Like, oh, that's all you're going to throw at me when I'm standing this close? Okay, I'll take this. Yeah, man, Kurosawa looks like he's just, you know, not gassing or getting tired at all. Ignacio looks like he's in tip-top shape as well. Doesn't look tired, but just you could just see his body language in the ring. It's just, you could see, he just doesn't feel confident in there yet.
It's that mental. He's breaking mentally, even though he's physically still there. But his confidence is going, and as soon as your confidence goes, it doesn't matter how much physical strength and ability you have.
And we've seen that a couple times. It's similar with Mackenzie Himes in that opening bout. You know, it's given everything she got, but just sometimes when it's not enough. As you said, you know, and with that, you know, Angulo fight, sometimes just surviving a tough fight like that can give you, can actually help you grow quite a bit, you know. Let's take a look at the replay, Kevin. What you see got going on here?
So he catches that right hand and has a little bit of confidence, but then Brandon comes right back in like nothing ever happened, lands a good body kick, and now you're back on the defensive again.
Referee Bam Stell, make sure everybody's ready to go.
Round number 5, your final round.
Fifth round of this highlighted amateur fight. Oh, looks like Ignacio is going to try to implement some spinning elbows. I think
good evasion by Brandon there to see it coming. Turned it against him.
Brandon's looking real sharp.
Yeah, beautiful head movement too. When Phillip catches those kicks, you know, that's a very dangerous spot, and Brandon sees it coming a mile away. I mean, he's missing him by a good foot.
Well, Brandon's got his groove going right now. He's feeling really comfortable. And he's looking at those targets, finding them, and again, earning that respect from Phillip with that body kick.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to see Brandon open up a little more hands and to set up that big, hard kick instead of looking for those single shots.
It's always funny when I call a fight with a coach who's fighter is fighting.
Whoa, big time. He said, oh, you're going to catch my kick? Catch three hooks right there.
You know, and that's actually something I go over with Brandon a lot, because he catches my kicks often. But I'm like, if you can't do anything with it, you're helping me out here. So you either got to do something with it or let it go, or someone's just going to sit there and slap you upside
the
head.
Yeah, right? So, yeah.
And there we see it applied.
Oh, nice left hand.
Nice, yeah.
Ignacio just can't find the answer to the pressure of Kurosawa right now. See the redness on the back of Ignacio starting to form here from those body kicks.
Yeah. All, like, every kick Brandon's thrown has been clean and hard.
Look at, oh, there's a nice right hand from Ignacio, but again, Kurosawa walking right through it. Oh, I like the way he switched stances and threw that power left kick there. He's really putting on a display. Looks like Kurosawa is feeling himself. I think it's official to say, guys. But, God, got to give it to Ignacio, because he's just trying everything he can to try to deter this attack of Kurosawa. But Kurosawa will not be stopped today. Nice kick to follow those hands.
Brandon, he's in the zone. He is in the zone, man.
What a wonderful sight to see two fighters of that level, guys. Put it on the line here in a five-round amateur fight, guys. I think unless there's some kind of huge issue here, it looks like Kurosawa did enough to take those rounds and take this five-round amateur highlighted bout here. This will be the last amateur bout of this Triumphant 9 card until we move into our pros. Again, guys, you got one more freebie fight, guys. A little teaser for you. One more. Going to give you that first pro fight, guys, to take a look at. Then you want to watch the rest of the card. Seven more pro fights with a WMC Intercontinental title and a Triumphant World Cruiserweight title on the line, guys. Only $7.99. Go to Triumphant Combat Sports Facebook page. Click the link and grab that stream right now. That's right, guys. One more. We're going to give you that first professional bout, guys, and then you'll need to grab the pay-per-view to watch the rest. You guys watching on Fight Hub TV right now, thanks for you guys to come through. Just witnessed a banger of a five-round amateur fight between Philip Ignacio and Brandon Kurosawa. And I was going to say, Kevin, when you commentate somebody's fight that you coach, people go, oh, well, are you biased towards them? And I always think, no, I think harder. Coaches are harder on their guys.
Yeah.
When they're sitting there, I told them to use their hands. Oh, well, here we're going to Dan Stell for the official announcement here as Pablo Flores calls out our
ladies and gentlemen, after five rounds of Muay Thai action, we go to the judges' scorecards. But before we go to the scores, big round of applause for both warriors, Kurosawa and Ignacio. All three judges, Dave Holtz, Jose Cobian, and Edgar Lopez, scored about 49-46. For your winner, by the way, of unanimous decision, from the boxing club in San Diego, California, Brandon Kurosawa!
Guys, ultimately, do you know what I think gave Brandon the edge in this fight? Is his name is Brandon, and you know, everyone named Brandon is an amazing person. So really, I mean, how could it go any other way?
It's almost not fair.
It's not fair. Never met a Brandon I didn't like.
Brandon Kurosawa improves to 14-1 and one draw. And Philip Ignacio goes to 20 with six losses. What a great fight. This is a great professional fight. Next professional fight, our last free fight, Cynthia Flores taking on Yasmin Sahani. This is a great, great pro fight here. I expect nothing but fireworks for female fights.
I do too. These ladies are opening up the professional portion of our card at 110 pounds. Sahani at the boxing club now in San Diego. She flew out from Philly for this reason. She said, that's where I want to train. I want to chase my professional career as a fighter. So she picked up, packed up, moved to California, started new. You know, you got to give a fighter that does that much, sacrifice that much, and makes those type of changes to improve their career, you got to give them some credit right off the bat.
Oh, without question, everybody says they're willing to do what it takes to get to the next level and to make it to the big show. But how many people actually are willing to put in the work, willing to sacrifice everything in order to make that dream possible?
Their whole life, really. Their whole life changes, you know. Hey, guys. Welcome, guys. We are here at the beautiful Rosarito Beach Resort in Rosarito, Baja California for Triumphant 9. Myself, Brandon Kyle, my co-host, David Huey, and, of course, the Soul Assassin, Kevin Ross, in the booth today. We've had some great action so far. We are coming up on our very first professional bout. Guys, again, this is the last bout you're going to be able to watch on Fight Hub for free. Then we need you to click on the Triumphant Combat Sports Facebook page. You'll be able to stream the rest of the fights there for $7.99, guys. It's what you spend on coffee and a bagel in the morning to get some live full rules Muay Thai action. The pros are coming in. Two titles will be on the line. WMC Intercontinental title between Jose Reyes and Zach Bunnell, and a world title from Triumphant, the inaugural cruiserweight title between Jacob Rodriguez and Alberto Amaro. Excited about that. Bunch of other great fights are on the card, guys. Stay tuned. Guys, you want to follow us on Instagram, guys, at Triumphant Combat Sports. You can find us there. You can find us on YouTube, Triumphant Combat Sports. You can find us on Facebook, Triumphant Combat Sports. You can find us
from
right
Mexico
here, right now,
City,
live on Fight Hub.
Cynthia Flores.
Pablo calling out the next fighter, Cynthia Garcia Flores. She's coming in with a 10-3 record. Quite a bit of experience fighting out of Mexico City at Cruz Fight Gym. Richard Cruz is her corner. Richard Cruz is also cornering his sister tonight, who's fighting. So two female fighters from this gym. I'm sure they help each other to sharpen the sword there. So excited to see what they are going to bring out of Mexico City here today. She's got 10 fights in Thailand. She's won a title in Thailand, a title in Tijuana. She likes to set large goals and conquer them. That's the reason why she's in the sport, David.
Yeah, she says she loves to kick and she loves the clinch, and she's going to put on a heat. Fighting in Thailand, you need to use that clinch, use that effectively. Let's see if she can put that work here against her opponent, Yasmin.
And from San Diego, California, Jasmine, the Jasmanian Devil Salhani.
That's right. Yasmin Salhani is also under that 110 weigh-in weight limit, coming in at 109. Moved from Philadelphia out to San Diego to train at the boxing club, where she knew she had to go to get the best out of herself. You got to appreciate that kind of heart. And we'll see if those sacrifices are going to pay dividends here in the Triumphant ring tonight.
Well, Yasmin describes herself as aggressive. She uses a lot of movement. She believes in her right cross. She calls herself the Yasminian Devil, much like the Tasmanian Devil, the Yasminian Devil. And she's going to apply some heat, put that devilish moves right now in this professional bout. Three-minute rounds of Muay Thai action. No elbow pads, because this is a professional bout. Here we go. Cynthia Flores, 10 wins against 2 defeats, taking on Yasmin on her third professional fight, coming in at 2-0, both identical age at 25. One inch separates them in height, contested at 110 pounds. Three rounds of full rules Muay Thai action.
There we go. We're going to Pablo Flores to give us our official announcement.
All right, the keys to victory right now, Cynthia Flores, she needs to apply that technique, that the things that she learned from Thailand, that clinch, use that and smother out the technique and apply her kicks and use it effectively. Yasmin, she brags about her right hand. She's going to use that cross. She's going to earn that respect from Cynthia Flores. If she can put that to work, use her movement, she can come out victorious. This is going to be a great bout here. Professional Muay Thai, no elbow pads. This is contested at 110 pounds. Three-minute rounds of professional Muay Thai women's action.
Let's send it to Pablo Flores to announce this next set of fighters.
Okay, all right.
Yeah, just got to match the gloves to the color of the corner.
That's what's important.
Red and blue, you know, pretty much. But once we get that settled, we'll be good to go. Let's take it to Pablo Flores, getting ready. I think we got our corners all settled now. Because it's important, you know. It is important.
Got to know
who we're looking at, you know.
Ladies and gentlemen, Triumphant number 9 presents Three rounds of Muay Thai action in the flyweight division. Your three judges scoring this bout in ringside. David Halls, Jose Covian, and Edgar Lopez. And your third man inside the ring, JJ Ferrado. Entries in first. The fighter standing in the Pharma Extracts blue corner. She wears multicolored trunks. Her official weight, 109.4 pounds. She stands with a professional record of 2 wins against no losses. She represents the Boxing Club San Diego, California, USA. Jasmine, the Jasmanian Devil Sohani. And her opponent across the ring is standing in the GoTV red corner. She wears black trunks with red and gold. She official weighs in 109.6 pounds in 13 professional bouts. She stands with 10 victories against 3 defeats. She represents Richard Cruz, Muay Thai Gym, Mexico City, Ciudad de Mexico, Cynthia Flores. And now with the following instructions, your referee in charge, JJ Ferrado. 3 rounds.
Guys, give me a clean professional fight, okay? We know the rules. Protect yourself at all times and always obey my instructions. Touch gloves and good luck to both of them.
Big crowd cheer you hear there for Cynthia Garcia Flores fighting in her home country of Mexico. You can hear, got a lot of support in the crowd behind her. Looks like she's pumped and ready to go. Flores wearing the red gloves, representing the red corner. Blue gloves, blue corner for Salhani. Here we go. Last second preparations from their corners.
And take a look at this beautiful view. Sitting out here, Rosarito, Mexico, right on the beachfront. This is the last of our free preview. Here we go for round number one.
They touch gloves and they are underway here. Salhani lifting that leg, fading that jab. Ooh, they trade kicks and punches and they are after it right off the bat, guys. Feel out right now.
Yeah. And Cynthia Flores throwing a flurry of punches and following with that kick.
Nice. Switch kick from Flores. Ooh, nice counter right hand from Salhani. Feint draws out a kick from Salhani.
Both fighters really haven't found their range yet, but they're trying to impose their will.
Very active, both fighters, though, David. Back and forth so far. Again, no one's landed anything too big. They're just kind of feeling themselves out.
Cynthia Flores with a really fast switch kick. Very impressed with that.
Sharp kicks all around. She throws those flurry of hands, which can catch you off guard because you only think one or two is coming, and 3 or 4 more come with it.
Yeah, definitely got some speed in those combinations there. But, you know, you can see that pro-level poise in both of these girls here as they kind of try to draw the other one out and see if they can get their opponent to make a mistake here. But both girls very technical, very sound so far.
That switch kick is lightning sharp.
It is very, very fast. And Yasmin with those longer punches coming in with that score. Her corner asking her to step in, feeling that she's a little bit too far out.
There you go, asking for leg kicks. Fighter hears her corner, gives them what they want. A little jumping deep kick there from Garcia Flores. Salhani circling. There we go. Nice inside kick, but a good counter right from Salhani as she eats the kick. 1-2-1. Ooh, looks like Cynthia's starting to heat it up. Starts coming with the elbows. Oh, big combination. Finish with a body kick here in Salhani's corner. Salhani circles out. Back to the middle. Having some mic issues here. Yeah.
Sensei's right hand by
Yasmin.
You know, I like the explosiveness of both of these fighters. They're in there, they're measuring their weight, and then boom, they just explode. A lot of heat coming out and a flurry of action. What a great first round.
Yeah, great opening round. David, you just saw that you know, both fighters kind of feel it out. You see them start to intensify as the round ended. What did you think, Kevin, of that very first round of this first pro fight?
Another close, evenly contested matchup. I'd give the edge to Cynthia over there. She was landing probably more and much sharper kicks. But they were really feeling each other out. I think Cynthia was really trying to impose her will and her pressure. But Yasmin did a good job of using her footwork, circling around, not getting trapped.
Yeah, she was able to counteract, especially when she got pushed to the corner. She's able to get out of that corner. She didn't take too much damage, but definitely a moving backwards to Cynthia's forward pressure there. We'll see if we can see, you know.
Let's take a look at some of the replay action right now. Here we go. Cynthia's coming in with that jump push kick, jump teep. Fighters measure up, and you can see that explosiveness coming out in Cynthia trying to cut off that ring. Here we go for round number two.
That's it. Look at that face.
Oh, yeah. You can tell Salhani has turned up the heat here in this one. You can see a little bit more intensity. Corner probably let her know she's got to have to really push, win these last two rounds if she wants to win the fight here. That first round could have gone towards her opponent. So looks like she's not taking any chances. She's turning it up in this second round. Ooh, two right hands missed for both girls. Nice low kick there from Garcia Flores. Garcia Flores overhand right kind of skims the cheek of Salhani there. Salhani trying to draw something, but Cynthia very poised in there, not really overcommitting to anything. But it seems like Salhani's starting to find her range here with a 1-2 body kick. 2 minutes left in this second round here. Coming with the elbow.
And Cynthia, yeah, really trying to use that elbow. She used that forward elbow, straight elbow, up elbow, chopped elbow. She's used that several times.
Feels like we're all holding our breath over here because it feels like at any moment a huge strike could land the way these girls are just barely missing. It's like inches away. You know, as one fighter starts to fatigue, that those inches might get closed and someone's going to get clipped here. Oh, there, nice right hand from Garcia Flores, but Salhani comes right back. Oh, big right hand and lands on the jawline of Salhani from Cynthia. She's coming forward now. She's landing those hands, really nice overhands and hooks, using the shorter opponent weapon she needs to land on Salhani.
Yasmin's corner wants her to push forward and use her hands to set up the techniques.
Nice, nice hand exchange. Clinch, girls, and JJ.
Cynthia using a really good left hook as Yasmin comes forward.
Nice leg kick.
Cynthia cannot wait to come forward. The ref was holding her back, and she just looked like she was ready to run him over to get to Yasmin Salhani here. Again, Cynthia Flores in those red gloves. Salhani in the blue.
Yeah, even though Cynthia's very aggressive forward fighter, she does a good job of staying composed, staying at the right distance, which can be a difficult thing when all you want to do is go forward. I tend to have that trouble myself.
Yeah, she does, again, doesn't put the brakes on, but she downshifts every now
and then. Just the right amount.
Ooh, that overhand barely missed there on Salhani again. Salhani eating those overhands. Ooh. Nice, but ooh, nice high kick. Kind of screeched past the glove guard of Salhani there.
Yeah, I feel like Cynthia is pulling away a little bit. I think her power and her speed is getting through to Yasmin, but Yasmin's not deterred.
It's not an overwhelming force there. You know, she's meeting it, and but it's just like those little exchanges. She's just seems like Cynthia Flores is just edging them out each time here.
Well, great action between them. You know, Yasmin's really trying to bait her with that shake and bake, trying to set up some fakes in there, but her corner wants her to march forward, wants her to use some combinations to set up some techniques. But Cynthia Flores, man, she just has a quick answer, a quick combination answer every time Yasmin comes in. This is the third and final round.
Yeah, what I would say to Yasmin is you gotta counter the counter when she's coming in first, but then Cynthia's having that explosion of quick strikes and disengages. You gotta stay engaged, keep the pressure going.
And let's take a look at one of those exchanges here as these girls go back and forth. David, what are you seeing in this replay?
And I just see that fast left switch kick, and I see that fast hand that Cynthia uses as Yasmin strikes. And as Kevin says, you know, you got to counter that counter. So that's the answer that Yasmin needs to do.
Well, the other thing, too, is when Cynthia does throw those combinations, there's not much thought or reason behind them. It's just as fast as I can get my hands to go. So you can find and thread the needle in there if you understand what they are doing.
Yeah, and they're talking about threading the needle. There's that right hand threading through here. Looks like Yasmin Salhani in the blue gloves. Her corner is giving her a little bit of fire to bring out in this third and final round here. But, man, when she's taking those exchanges like that, every time she throws, she seems to catch one. It's going to be a difficult task to try to overcome in this third round. Let's see if Salhani can maybe score a knockdown and try to even up this fight here. I know she's going to go for it. But great control from both fighters in this very first professional bout of Triumph at 9. Nice low kick, but those hands. Seems like every time she throws a kick, she has to deal with two or three punches coming back. And
yeah,
as you said, they don't always land, but right. it just is deterring it, you know?
Yeah, it definitely deters you from wanting to do anything. You know, I can land a really great body kick, a really great leg kick, but I'm going to get hit with 17 different things after the fact.
Oh, you know, nice 1-2, though. Oh, these girls are banging in the pocket with these short hooks. Nice body kick attempt there from Garcia Flores. Garcia Flores focused.
Yeah.
Ooh, a little bounce switch kick. Looks like Salhani, though, driving her back. Hits her with a nice right hand, but Cynthia Flores unfazed, seemingly, from it.
In her corner, Yasmin's corner, calling out for that 1-2, calling out for that cross coming forward because it's finding its mark.
Got Garcia Flores got that little bounce going now, like she's almost trying to, you know, use a little bit of a different timing to finish out this third round. 1 minute left in this third and final round of this professional fight. The first one on this triumphant card. Last fight you're going to get, guys, before you got to switch over to the Triumphant Combat Sports Facebook page and grab that pay-per-view. Only $7.99, guys.
And how would you not want to do that with an action like this?
Yes, if you've been watching so far, guys, it's going to be a pretty easy choice to switch over that Facebook and grab that pay-per-view right now. Appreciate all you guys watching on Fight Hub TV as we finish the last part of this third and final round. Let's see if Salhani can do what it takes to finish the job here.
Nice spin back fist and some heavy hands from Cynthia.
Cynthia coming forward.
That switch kick from Cynthia is just a thing of beauty. She gets it up there so quickly to the head.
Corner calling for Salhani to come forward and keep throwing. But you know, it's tough when you got counters and punches coming back at you. She's trying to find her opening. Was able to land that low kick without taking anything back, but it doesn't stop Cynthia Flores from coming forward. And talk about coming forward. Here she goes. Swinging for the fences. She's looking for that knockout in that last 10 seconds of that third and final round. What a great fight between these two females.
That was beautiful. And all these matchups have been great. Great stylistic matchups, skill. And I think that's such an important factor in getting the sport to grow is quality matchups. Not just having great people on the card, but throughout, amateurs, pros.
Oh, absolutely, and this is the last fight you're going to get on free. This free preview on Fight Hub TV. Subscribe right now. Get that pay-per-view for only $7.99. We still have six more professional bouts, including the WMC Intercontinental title and also the Triumphant World title. It's a great card, and it's so inexpensive. And you know what? You have action like this, nonstop action like this, as we've seen, this is a place to go.
And again, guys, as we await the final decision of this professional women's Muay Thai fight, guys, hope you're enjoying the action so far. Make sure to switch over to Triumphant Combat Sports Facebook page. Sign up and get that stream. Kevin, we're checking out a little replay here, that final round.
Ooh, just missed the spinning back fist.
She was looking for it. She was looking for that finish, though.
Yeah, Yasmin was having a hard time because she would land a good solid leg kick, good solid punch, but then Cynthia would unload with that flurry, and it's very deterring. Every time you land a good shot, somebody's hitting you with six, seven other things.
Cynthia Flores limps over to find out the final decision. What a great fight between these two. What a great performance from Cynthia.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds of Muay Thai action, we now go to the judges' scorecards. Another big round of applause for the Jasmanian Devil, Sahani, and Cynthia Flores. Judge Jose Covian, he scores it 30-27 in favor of Flores. Dave Holtz, 30-27 in favor of Sahani. And Edgar Lopez, he scores it 30-27. For your winner, by the way, of split decision. From Mexico City, Ciudad de Mexico, Cynthia.
That's an interesting split decision, but I think the right fighter got that one. Kevin got the nod on that one, you know.
At least bad scoring is consistent across the world, so.
Inconsistency, you mean? The one thing about...
No, there is consistency in bad judging.
In the inconsistency of the judging?
Yeah. Yeah, there's been... I think every fight has had one of the judges... I think they were watching the ocean or something. It's a little difficult out here.
Let's go find... Yeah, we have Stevie Wonder as a guest judge here today. He's listening and...
He's been working a lot lately, I find. Him and...
I've noticed that in all states and all countries across the world.
At least he's working.
And we're going to the last 10 seconds where Cynthia Flores comes forward. She looked like the Tasmanian Devil in that.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. Yeah. She was the one that...
She was the one doing the whirling dervish of punches there. So, yeah, looks like that was enough to get her the victory there. Second open. Got you. Thank you, guys. You guys, we just want to thank everyone on Fight Hub TV who tuned in to see those first four fights of this Triumphant Nine.